Good morning, everyone. A happy Sabbath to you all. It's a beautiful, warm day, so I give you a beautiful, warm welcome to our church service this morning. And a special welcome to Brother Orhue. As you know, he'll be leaving us soon, but today is his last opportunity to share God's message with us here at Hinkler, so we welcome him. Also, a welcome to our many visitors. Quite a few of our members are away on holidays, and it's good to see visitors come and choose to worship here with us. A welcome too to those who are at home watching online. May God bless you. May the Holy Spirit give you a blessed Sabbath day also. Just a reminder that the second Sabbath in January, that's the 13th of January, after divine service, we're having a special luncheon to farewell Brother Orhue. And the lunch itself will be provided by the church. And the request is that we bring drinks and desserts, yummy desserts, for afterwards, so that we can all give a fond farewell to Brother Orhue as he goes up north. Not happy about it, but we'll enjoy a meal together, brother. I would ask the deacons to come forward now, please, and collect our building offering. Shall we pray? Heavenly Father, we thank you for your blessings to us. We thank you for giving us the means that we can share this building offering. Please bless this money that's been given, and may it be used well in your service. We ask these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us dedicate this time now to our God and come to a place of quiet rest near to the heart of God and sing hymn number 495, Near to the Heart of God.
Thank you.
Let us speak to our God. Would you take a position of prayer? Heavenly Father, this morning as we come together to worship you on this your Sabbath day, we're grateful for the blessings that you've poured out upon us. Heavenly Father, as we look around us at the world and see the turmoil and strife, we realize that the coming of Jesus is getting closer, and we look forward to that day. But we're so grateful that in all the turmoil around us, we have this 24-hour period that you have set aside that we can spend the time in quiet with you and with each other. Heavenly Father, thank you for the presence of your Holy Spirit here with us today, within each heart. And we ask a special blessing on our brother Orhue as he opens your word to us this morning. Heavenly Father, please speak to us through your word that we may be drawn closer to Jesus, nearer to your heart. Heavenly Father, please bless those of our members who are not present today because of sickness or holidays. Heavenly Father, bless each one that they too may have a blessed Sabbath day wherever they are. Lord, we ask your blessing on other churches in this district. May their lights shine too, so that all glory will be given to you. Heavenly Father, shut us in now with your holy angels as we worship you this morning. We ask these blessings in Jesus' name. Amen. The deacons will now collect our tithes and offering, and this morning your offering is for local church expenses. Thank you, deacons.
Let us bow our heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, what a merciful God you are. We thank you so much, Lord, for blessing us with many bounties, for giving us health, for blessing us with means to work, and the privilege to contribute to society. Father, with that, Lord, comes blessings in monetary form and other forms, and we just pray, Lord, that with our tithes, that we have the privilege to return them, and that we also have even an amazing opportunity to give offering as well. Father, please bless these means, bless these funds, let it go far and wide, let it reach the unreached peoples of the earth, and we just pray, Lord, that we can participate in mission in this way. Thank you so much, in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus, amen. All right, good morning and happy Sabbath. It's so awesome to see so many visitors here. It's very wonderful. I just pray that you guys will feel welcome and comfortable here. Now, this is one of my favorite times of the divine service. I have a beautiful children's story that I want to share with each and every one of you. So could the boys and girls please come down, and I've got a surprise for you. Look at that. Look at all these boys and girls. Have you guys been good? Oh, I don't know. Have you guys been good? Oh, very good. That's what I like to hear. Now, boys and girls, I have a special surprise for you. Let me just put myself in a better position. I have a very special surprise for you. Now, let me show you what it is. Some of you guys may have seen it, but maybe not. Does anyone know what this is? Who said that? Wow, very good. How did you know what it is? Have you ever seen a human brain before? Wow, very good. Now, this is a very special brain. Do you know which animal I may have got this from? Oh, very good. Exactly. I got it from, this is a sheep's brain. I made sure that it wasn't any other one. I made sure it wasn't a human brain, thankfully. And it wasn't an unclean animal, because I know that I might get into trouble with the elders. So this is a clean animal, and it's a sheep's brain. And now, each and every one of us, we all have a brain, right? Does anyone know what the brain does? Very good. Wow, that I love that answer. That's a very comprehensive answer there. What about? Helps you think. Oh, that's important, isn't it? Yeah, we can't without the brains, we can't think. That's for sure. Yeah, and you?
It helps you walk, stand, maybe body.
Helps you walk. Are you guys scientists? Wow, you guys are very good. And you know what? Each of us have a brain. And do you know how to tell how big your brains are? How do you tell? Very good. We've got a very clever one here. So if you put your two fists like this, you can actually get a rough idea of how big your brain is. Isn't that cool? So it's really interesting because our brains are very special things. It can do a lot of amazing things like you've mentioned. It can even, one of the things that wasn't quite mentioned, that even things that we're not aware of, it helps us in those important functions as well, like our breathing. Do you know that your brain is important for your breathing? And there's a part of the brain called the brain stem that's very, very important for that. And if that's, you know, anything goes wrong there, we won't be able to breathe. And it helps with all the other things as well. Now, the reason why our brains are important is that we have so much potential with our brains, isn't it? Each and every one of you guys are capable of so many things. How many things do you reckon you can remember with your brain? Do you reckon you can remember this much or this much? How much do you reckon, how much can you fit in your brain? Sorry? Yeah, it's unlimited. You're absolutely right. There's so many things that we have not even scratched the surface of what our brains can do. Isn't that special? Now, because of that, because the brain is so powerful, we have to be careful of what we put in our brains, isn't it? Do you think that, you know, if we know that the brain is capable of doing all these awesome things, that we need to be careful of what we look at, what we eat, you mentioned all the senses, you know, what we touch, all those things can shape our brain. Now, this specimen that I have here, this sheep's brain, you can probably imagine what it feels like. What do you reckon it feels like?
Squishy.
Squishy, yeah, that's right. The closest thing I could probably think of, it's probably very dissimilar, but just bear with me with this illustration. It's kind of like Play-Doh or clay, right? Squishy, and you can kind of mold it the way you want it, right? Have any of you guys played with Play-Doh or clay before? I'm sure we all have. I used to enjoy that when I was a kid. And you can make all sorts of things with Play-Doh, right? You can make good things. You can make some not so good things too with it. And here are some examples of how you can use clay to make some nice pottery. And the way you make these products is that you need to add some water in it, and then you give it time to set. And because that time that you have, you use that time to make what you need to make. Otherwise, it gets dry. If it gets dry, then you've run out of time, and you've made what you've made in that time. Unless you put more water, of course. Now, sometimes it can end up a bit of a mess like this. Have any of you guys had a go with, you know, using clay? Sometimes if you're not careful, it can end up looking like a dog's breakfast like that. Sometimes you can have some not so, you know, interesting things. This is a bit weird, isn't it? But actually, if you're really gentle and very skillful, you can make something really beautiful like this. Isn't that beautiful? Or like this, with all the pretty patterns and all those things. There are lots of different things we can do with clay. And our brains are exactly like that. You know, we have to be careful of what we put in our brains, because what we put in our brains depends, it governs how our brains will end up being like, whether we end up having good brains that reflect God's glory or not so good brains. Here's a very special verse that I really like. Isaiah chapter 64, verse 8. But now, O Lord, thou art our Father, and we are the clay, and thou art potter, and we all are the work of thy hand. Boys and girls, do you want to allow Jesus to form and make you who you want to be when you grow up?
Yes.
Well, it's important to follow the advice of God's word, amen, and follow the advice of your parents too. Let's close our hands in prayer, okay? Heavenly Father, great God of the universe, thank you so much, Lord, that you've blessed us with these beautiful brains. Father, we know, Lord, that it has the potential for good, but also the potential for not so good things. Father, help us, Lord, to follow your example so that we can reflect fully the image of Jesus. We ask this in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen. All right, boys and girls, you can go back quietly, okay? We'll go to the next hymn, hymn number 318, and then we'll go to the scripture reading afterwards. Hymn number 318, if you have that with me, and please stand with me for this beautiful hymn. Hymn number 318.
Bring down every idol.
Good morning, and once again, happy Sabbath. I'm really looking forward to share what God has placed in my heart this morning. And it's an absolute privilege to be here with you. It's a privilege to stand before you today in spite of my inadequacies. I was just reflecting, you know, about a bit over 12 months ago, I remember requesting Elder Clive not to put me on the preaching roster because things got a bit too busy, and turns out that God had other plans. Somehow God managed to allow me to preach three times this year. But it's amazing that, you know, when God implores us to do something, he enables us, amen? And we can be really encouraged by that God enables the called. And God is good, amen? And I believe that when God is calling you to do something, he gives us the strength to do it. And therefore, I thank God once again for this opportunity. And I want to invite you guys to please keep me in prayer, by the way, as I stand before you this morning. It hasn't been an easy week. I must be honest with you. I was battling the flu, and you know, had other issues. You know, Satan has a way of trying to buffet you when you're preparing for something that's really important, isn't it? And I believe that it's because God has something really special that he wants us to understand this morning. As we come to an end of an era, at the end of a year, my aim this morning is to position ourselves as a church for wonderful, powerful changes that is coming in our lives as we transition into the new year, amen? Brothers and sisters, I have a question for you. Do you want to experience big, monumental changes in your life next year? Is that your desire, brothers and sisters? Do you want to experience lasting, sustainable change? Where for, I know once a year we do a New Year's resolution. They're not just kept, but they actually become a catalyst for a new life. Is that your desire? A new mindset? And by God's graces, maybe even a new brain. And in turn, through the sanctification process, a new person in Jesus. Is that your desire, brothers and sisters? Before we pray, let's open the Word of God. And I want to show you this memory verse. I want to show you something very peculiar. Our memory verse is Jeremiah chapter 31, verses 29 to 30. I'm reading from the King James Version. And the prophet Jeremiah, he's known as the weeping prophet, isn't he? And I want to whet your appetite with this following scripture. It reads, "In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten a sour grape and the children's teeth are set on edge. But every one shall die for his own iniquity. Every man that eateth the sour grape, his teeth shall be set on edge." As we ponder on these words, let us ask the Holy Spirit to gain a deeper understanding into what God wants to teach us this morning. Bow our heads. Heavenly Father, great God of the universe, Father, Lord, you know my inadequacies better than anyone in the universe. So, Father, I pray that you will strengthen me, that you will cover me with your grace and your Holy Spirit. Hide me behind your cross. Obliterate self and take away my stutter. Father, I thank you so much for your loving kindness and your loving mercies. And we pray, Lord, that we will leave different than when we came in. Thank you, Father. We ask this in the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen. The title for our message, brothers and sisters, is Battle of the Brains, How We Can Obtain Victory in the Brain. The brain is arguably the most fascinating organ in your body, in my humble opinion. Weighing about 1.5 kilos, it is the only field of science in the universe where the subject studies itself. It is literally a living supercomputer encased in a room called the skull or brain box, and it floats in a cushion of fluid called the cerebral spinal fluid, so that it offsets that 1.5 kilos weight and you don't notice that you're carrying that kind of weight above your neck. 60% of the human brain, by the way, is made of fat. Not only does this make it the fattiest organ in the human body, but those crucial fatty acids are essential for optimal performance, and it encapsulates why it's important to feed your brain with the right nutrition. Amen? Your brain's storage capacity is considered virtually unlimited, as I hinted at the children's story. Research suggests the human brain consists of about 86 billion neurons. Each neuron forms connections with other neurons, and which could add up to 1 quadrillion or 1,000 trillion connections, different types of connections that can potentially happen. Over time, these neurons can combine, and therefore, the storage capacity can increase even further. So you can picture in your mind the scope of the human brain is immense. The human brain generates about 23 watts of power, and which is enough to power a light bulb. And you can imagine that all that power requires much needed rest, isn't it? That's why it's important to have rest, to have good sleep. Did you know that a piece of brain tissue the size of a grain of sand contains 100,000 neurons and 1 billion synapses? Did you know that? Immense capabilities that our loving Father has created. By the way, our brain isn't fully formed up until the age of 25. And brain development begins from the back of the brain and works its way to the front, back to front. Therefore, your frontal lobes, the frontal lobes, which control planning and reasoning, are the last to strengthen and structure connections. So now I want to challenge that this morning, brothers and sisters. I want to ask to dig deeper because we have now new research that actually potentially suggests otherwise. But there's a bit of nuance to that, and we're going to go into that a bit further. Yet, in spite of what we know about our brains, there is still much that is shrouded in mystery. It is truly the last frontier in our knowledge in medical science. We still have questions. For example, is the brain merely just a physical entity? Or we can also, just through our experience and through our understanding of what we know about the brain, suggest that the brain also may have some spiritual entities as well, because it's our minds that we use to interact with our Lord and Savior, isn't it? You know, it's our frontal lobes that we engage in the process of spirituality. Human beings, God created us to be spiritual beings, amen? Now, so there's still questions that we have to unlock. And the other questions like, where do thoughts come from? And is it purely a biochemical or a spiritual process? And how can we unlock the full potential of this supercomputer that we have in our brains? And can our brains truly change after the age of presumed development in a physical sense after we reach adulthood? That's the question we want to answer. In our time this morning, we will attempt to scratch the surface. But more importantly, we want to look at this knowledge through the lens of the cosmic conflict that we are facing and how we can use this in our advantage in our struggle in this great controversy that each of us must face. In fact, let's look at Hosea chapter 4, verse 6. It says, "My people are destroyed for lack of, because thou hast rejected knowledge, I will also reject thee, that thou shalt be no priest to me, seeing thou hast forgotten the law of thy God, I will also forget thy children." Is that verse is continues there. Brothers and sisters, when we reject knowledge, we reject an opportunity to better understand how we can keep God's law faithfully. And we know that the essential foundation in keeping God's law faithfully is righteousness by faith. And as we delve into scripture this morning, we want to also delve into the annals of the latest in neuroscience that will help achieve this righteousness by faith experience in our lives. Now, one person that has made a valiant effort in helping us better understand the brain is this man. Does anyone recognize this man? This man goes by the name of Dr. Harvey Cushing. Does it ring a bell? Dr. Harvey Cushing is known as the father of neurosurgery. He dared to venture into the inner sanctuary of the brain box and pioneered much of the foundation techniques that surgeons use today in operating into the brain in a safe manner. Techniques include things like how to control bleeding, different techniques on how to create a bloodless field to operate on so that you can see what you're doing. As well as, he was also involved in some of the earliest classifications of brain tumors as well. And he was also quite the artist, a great illustrator. He would draw very detailed maps of the brain and detailed sketches on anatomy, and he was quite a very talented fellow. But as great as his efforts was, he could not foresee the advances in our current understanding of the brain, which we now know as neuroplasticity. Can everyone say neuroplasticity? Brothers and sisters, let us go back to our memory verse here. Jeremiah chapter 31, verse 29. Jeremiah 31, verse 29. It reads the following. I want to read this microscopically, brothers and sisters. In those days they shall say no more, the fathers have eaten a sour grape and the children's teeth are set on edge. Now, just reflect on this. This must have been a very common idiom that was said back in those days, isn't it? And we, in some ways, we say similar things today. You know, we say things that similar things like, you know, I'm born with what I am is what I was born with, or we say something similar is I can't change because, you know, my parents gave me these traits. We have very similar sayings, and you know, we say things like we inherit, you know, the traits and the errors of our parents. Brothers, sisters, the question I'm going to ask is this: are we the victims to the shortcomings of our ancestors? It's a bit of a trick question. Are we necessarily the victims of the shortcomings of our ancestors? It depends on how you understand victim, right? Yes, we do inherit some of our undesirable traits of our parents, but we also are not bound by those outcomes. We have the ability to change. We are not held in bondage to the chains of the things that we inherited from our parents. And that gives us hope. Some of us have a stronger proclivity to certain sins, whether it's alcohol or smoking, lust, all of these are all potentially inherited. But let me ask you, brothers and sisters, we are not merely the victims of our shortcomings. Amen? Let us look at what the Bible says as we continue through Jeremiah. Some really crucial insights. It says here as we continue on, but everyone shall die for his own iniquity. Every man that eateth the sour grape, his teeth shall be set on edge. No, brothers and sisters, we will be victims of our own shortcomings and suffer the natural consequences of our actions if we don't repent. But there's hope. There's hope. And this hope is called righteousness by faith, brothers and sisters. And it's encapsulated in the following verses. In the verse 31, it says, behold, the days come, says the Lord, that will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Not according to the covenant that I made with your fathers in the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt, which my covenant they break, although I was a husband unto them, says the Lord. So see, God is, he's pleading the case. He's saying, look, I was faithful. It was you guys that broke that old covenant. Nonetheless, it says in verse 33, but this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel. After those days, says the Lord, I will put my law in your inward parts and write it in your hearts, and will be their God, and there will be my people. Brothers and sisters, can we say a hearty amen to that? Amen. We call this righteousness by faith, brothers and sisters, a faith that is active. Yes, you do have a role to play in this faith. And that role is involved in cooperating with God's agency to true, long-lasting change in our lives, structural, substantive change. In other words, instead of trying to be holy under the old covenant, you know, the Israelites said, yes, everything that you ask us to do, we will do. But they ended up failing, isn't it? Because they were trying to be holy. Instead, what I implore you through our understanding of neuroplasticity is that instead of trying, we can actually train. It's training our everyday habits by guided by His Word. And by so doing, by training every day the good habits that is instructed by the Word, it allows Jesus to complete the transformation in us until the day of His return. Amen? Let me make this even clearer. In essence, it is fixing our attention on Jesus through the precepts of his word. And by so doing, we become changed. Amen? This change, and this is an amazing thing. Based on our understanding of the brain, we know that this change is not just on a spiritual level, but our brains literally changes physically. Did you know that? Our brain literally changes physically. And we best understand this through the concept of neuroplasticity. What is neuroplasticity, you may ask? Neuroplasticity is basically machine learning before there was ever a thing called machine learning. Except there's nothing artificial about this intelligence. Previously thought to only occur in children, because children's brains are very plastic, very malleable. However, neuroscientists now know that our brains have the ability to change in structure and function. The level of change depends on the frequency and intensity of the stimulus. Brothers and sisters, neuroplasticity is activity driven. In other words, we've all heard of this saying before, use it or lose it. One example that illustrates this best was an experiment that was done at a famous school in Spain for the blind. Brothers and sisters, we have different portions of the brain, and they all have different functions. And one of those portions in the rear, for example, is known as the occipital lobe. The occipital lobe is responsible, which is at the back of your brain, responsible for receiving the information from your eyes. And for the longest time, we thought that the occipital lobe was only restricted to perform that function. We've always thought, okay, that's the role it functions, that's all it does, you know, let it be. But actually, scientists have discovered through several different experiments, and one of these experiments they did at this school of the blind, said that that's not quite true. What happened is that they gave these teachers an experience of what it's like to be blind. So what they did was that they gave them each a special blindfold, but it wasn't like any other blindfold, because sometimes you can blindfold me and you can kind of tell lights and basic direction, but they made sure that they completely lost their sight and there was no perception of light that they could appreciate. No stimulation of light was afforded to them. So what happened was that what they discovered is that when they take these individuals and they completely block out all the stimulation from light entering into the retina, what ends up happening is that within a very short time period, actually within the course, what I found in this experiment was that within the course of 2 days, what begins to happen in the occipital lobe is that the portion of the brain that is typically receiving the information from what we see actually starts to take on other senses, whether it's a sense of touch, the sense of hearing, sense of taste. It begins to take on the roles of other functions. And in such short space of time, only 2 days, brothers and sisters, your brain can change. Your brain can change and it is transformed. What we can learn from it is that your brain can change depending on what we allow to go through our senses. This is why this great controversy is crucial, because the brain is the battleground in which the great controversy is fought, ultimately. And we can understand, we now are able to understand this change even at a microscopic level. So, as I've mentioned before, all our different senses help contribute to the formation of our brains and how we end up becoming what we allow to see, what we allow to touch. You can imagine the lasting impacts that what you see or what you eat can have on the structure of your brain. So let's go through this neuroplasticity concept in greater detail. So there are two forms of changes in your brain or neuroplasticity. One is called temporary, or we can classify this as short-term memory, and one is more longer-lasting. We classify this as long-term memory. Short-term memory occurs at a chemical level, or synapses, which are the areas between when one nerve cell joins with another nerve cell. So it occurs at that local level there. Whereas more long-lasting change can occur in two forms. One is at a structural level, And that at that structure level, you actually end up having new connections, completely new connections, and new changes to the surface of your brain, which is very fascinating. The other level that it can occur at is at a functional level. At that level, you actually can completely change the actual job that the parts of the brain can do. One of the crucial things that is noticed here is that you can actually have neurotransmitters, which is the information that is sent between different nerve cells. They can actually change in terms of the type of neurotransmitters can change completely. So you can have a brain that is normally designed to inhibit sorts of information, and on the other hand, you can have another. It can actually change to more excitatory or vice versa. So, which is very fascinating at a biochemical level. At a biochemical level. Now, the level of these changes depends on, and the longer lasting effects of those changes depends on your experience. And one of the things that we notice is that people who go through extreme stress are able to maintain those changes for longer periods of time. I'm sure you can reflect that you tend to remember the traumatic things in your life, right? The things that are traumatic, they tend to stick the longest. It's the same when it comes to permanent changes in your brain. You can change the nature of the brain, but often it requires a lot of repetition or the intensity has to increase. And I believe that God has put this experience in our lives, in this great controversy, and we call that trials, right? God allows us to go through stressful situations called trials to change our characters, to change our hearts, to allow more permanent changes in our character. So that eventually, when Jesus returns, he comes with a finished product. But if we are not willing to go through the trials, if we're not willing to be baked through the fiery furnace, just as the clay needs to be baked through the oven to be a finished product, our hearts need to go through the fiery experiences of trials to experience that long-lasting permanent changes in the brain that is possible. Isn't that exciting? Isn't that exciting? Now, can anyone think of any examples of prophets in the Bible who have engaged in this process of brain change? Can anyone think of any example?
Paul?
Look at Hosea? That's a good one. That's a good one. Elijah. Good one. Anyone else? Anyone else?
Moses.
Moses, yes. All of these, I mean, what about Enoch? But one person that I find really fascinating is Daniel. So, just a kind of reminder, you can actually see some of the deleterious effects of your brain that can occur when you put into your mind toxic things into our minds. You can see that your brain actually changes for the worse, and this is a healthy brain, this is a different types of addictions that occur and how it can actually change physically. So it works both ways. It works both ways. Now, I want to focus on Daniel's prayer life, because Daniel's experience must be our experience. You know, if we are to go through this great controversy experience, if we are to experience the same neuroplasticity that Daniel was able to experience, we must follow his example. For example, let's go right back to the beginning of his career. Daniel had a pattern of praying 3 times a day. That was the inbuilt habits instructed by the Word of God that he implemented in his life from a very young age. Prayer is that repetition, that consistency is going to have an effect on his brain development, isn't it not? Especially at an early young age. And then when we look at, when he comes into, you know, when he gets admitted to the Babylonian University, he makes a commitment. What is that commitment that he purposed in his heart? We all know this story. He purposed in his heart that he would not defile himself, including the king's food. You can imagine some people would see that this is just a minuscule matter. You know, why does it matter of what we eat? But no, not for Daniel. Daniel made it a decisive decision that he would not even compromise even in that area of his life. So he said, no, I will not partake in the king's food. I'm going to eat the vegetables instead and water. And what was the result of that experiment. The Bible tells us that he underwent neuroplasticity, did he not? 10 times wiser than his colleagues, right? So his brain was so developed, so advanced, obviously through the help of the Holy Spirit, but also that he was, you know, he cooperated with God, did he not? By his diligence. And he ended up becoming 10 times wiser. Brother says, that is the potential that I want each and every one of us to have. That is not restricted. God has no respect of persons. He wants that for each and every one of you. Amen? Now, we also know, as I mentioned, that neuroplasticity, for this to occur long-lasting, we need to go through trials. What kind of trials did Daniel go through? One of the first trials came very early in his experience when we got in the food issue. You know, that was a very controversial issue at the time. You know, his brothers went through the fiery furnace. They all stuck it together. And then he himself, he was throwing in the lion's den. Those are very severe trials, brothers and sisters. But he was a better person for it, amen? Brothers and sisters, this must be our experience. This must be our story. And by so doing, we will become victors through the strength of Jesus Christ. Amen. And we see that he was able to reach up to the heights. He was second in command in 2 different administrations. Amen. All because of his faithfulness. What a testimony. What a testimony. Amen. I'd like to just remind ourselves with this following text. This text has a very powerful implication of what we're talking about this morning. Romans chapter 12, verse 2. It says, "And be not conformed to this world, but be ye transformed by the renewing of your mind, that ye may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Brothers and sisters, this transformation, you need to allow time for this to happen. That is why backsliding must be dealt as a very serious issue, because you can imagine you're making all this progress. You know, you're gaining grace day by day, strength by strength, walking in the light that God has shown you. And then when we backslide, we have the potential to, if we're not careful, if we don't go back to Jesus straight away, to undo the hard work that has been done through your mind. So that's very, very important that we stay the course. Amen? That's very important that we stay the course, because we want to eventually, what does it say? We want to eventually to prove that good, an acceptable and perfect will of God. And that is a lifelong process of sanctification. Amen? Matthew chapter 6, verses 22 to 23 reads, "The light of the body is the eye. If therefore thine eye be single, thy whole body shall be full of light. But if thine eye be evil, thy whole body shall be full of darkness. If therefore the light that is in thee be darkness, how great is that darkness." Brothers and sisters, again, we have that dichotomy. You know, we can either feed our brains with light, or we end up feeding our brains with darkness. And it has detrimental effects to the rest of the body. It says very clearly in Scripture. And as we wind down, I'd like to show you this verse as well, Philippians chapter 2, verses 5 to 8. It says, "Let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus." But that same mind that is in Jesus, God wants to, if he could transplant into our brains, he would. But we need to go through this process where we allow the same mind that was in Jesus to be in us as well. "Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation, and took upon him the form of a servant, or was made in the likeness of man. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself, and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross." Brothers and sisters, is that your desire this morning? To emulate the pattern of Jesus, those characteristics that has been described here, the humility? It doesn't come overnight. Those things, when if we want to have the full stature of Jesus, that comes with time. Okay. And Ephesians chapter 4, verses 20 to 23 reads, "But you have not so learned Christ." I mean, do you really know Christ? "You have not so learned Christ. If so be that you have heard him and have been taught by him, as the truth is in Jesus, that you put off concerning the former conversation, the old man, which is corrupt according to the deceitful lusts, and be renewed in the spirit of your mind, brothers and sisters. Time and time again, Scripture is imploring us to engage in this process of neuroplasticity, this change. And when we engage in it properly, those changes we know can actually be long-lasting. We don't have to worry that we're going to undo all the hard work, because instead of trying to be holy, we are training our habits towards holiness. Amen? Brothers and sisters, I want to ask you this question. When all is said and done, what kind of a brain will you be bringing to heaven? Because brothers and sisters, we are not, you know, there are a lot of things in this world that we're not going to be able to bring with us. We're not going to bring our careers, our houses, or anything else. But what we do, there are two things we will bring. We'll bring the souls that we've won with Jesus, and also the characters that we've developed over time. And that character is the process of neuroplasticity through righteousness by faith, which ends up changing the structure of your brain physically. And as you engage in that process, you have new thoughts and feelings, which is our character. That is the process that God is calling us today. And I want to invite each and every one of you this morning, as we close here, to engage in this process. It's not an easy process, but it's a process that will yield dividends in the future. Is that your desire this morning, brothers and sisters? To give your lives wholeheartedly to Jesus as we turn through a new year, to engage in this process, to ensure that that New Year's resolution doesn't become something that comes in one day and goes the next, but they become long-lasting change when we go through it scientifically and with the help of Jesus. My brothers and sisters, let us all implore ourselves to engage in this work. Amen. Please bow our heads just before we sing, as we pray. Heavenly Father, great God of the universe, we long for this change in our lives. Without you, we cannot do nothing. And I thank you, Lord, that you've given us this information to encourage us to make long-lasting changes in our lives. Father, please be with us as we engage in this process. In the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen. Okay. So we're now going to finish with our final hymn, hymn number 567. It's one of my all-time favorite hymns. Have thine own way, Lord. And I pray that that is our wish this morning, to allow Jesus to have his own way with us.
Father,
dear Father in heaven, may you please be with us as we embark through another week. Give us strength, give us courage to follow the right. Help us, Lord, to allow our brains to be transformed by you, that it may fully reflect the character of Jesus. Father, as we embark in this new year that is about to come upon us, let it be the catalyst of wonderful, powerful changes in our lives, and that we may be able to have a testimony by this time next year to say that we have truly grown closer to you. Father, we ask this through the name of your Son, Christ Jesus. Amen. Amen. Thank you.